This is Tammy Lane. She is a seventh grade teacher in the building, and she's also a STEM teacher. Kevin Ross, it was slated to come tonight, but he had some family medical situations he had to deal with, so he sends his apologies to you guys. But you asked for an update on STEM this evening. So what we did was try to make it concise right here, page and a half. This is our fourth year of STEM in the building, and Tammy has been involved from the ground level as well as Kevin. They both went to training this summer 4 years ago, and they have each, Tammy teaches the seventh grade, Kevin teaches the eighth grade, and Kevin teaches the related arts piece of it, the robotics, the electric piece. So that's what the first paragraph basically says here. What we did 4 years ago is we took our science class, which is four quarters, we took a quarter of it away, so we teach three quarters of science, the book of science, earth science, and not biology, but earth science, life science, thank you. And then the kids get one quarter of STEM, okay? So three quarters of science and one quarter of STEM. In seventh grade, Tammy teaches the design and modeling, which is the first bullet, okay? And she'll talk a little bit about the software and so forth. In eighth grade, Kevin teaches the second bullet, which is the engineering and environment. And Tammy can talk about that tonight since Kevin's not here. The third bullet is a related arts class, so if I don't want chorus or band or art or whatever, I can sign up for robotics. So Kevin teaches that as an elective. If you turn the page, this past summer, Kevin got trained in medical detectives, and we're hoping to put that in place next year in the building as an elective for students. And then a goal, future planning, is obviously the green architecture, because the kids are heavily involved in that type of things and interest. We're not trained in that area yet. We'll have to get staff trained, but that would be the next piece at the middle school level where we'd be looking to go with green architecture. If we go the opposite way, taking things to sixth grade, we would look at some of the other programs to train in that area that also are available for a sixth, eighth grade program. But we're just talking about what we've got going on right now, okay? So I think what I'll do right now is I'll have Tammy talk about the seventh grade piece and the eighth grade piece, and then maybe what we'll do is ask questions with each unit or module, and then overall questions, because I know there's several tech questions that we have here that Tammy can answer too, okay? So I'll sit down, and Tammy can take over on that side.
Okay. In the seventh grade, the design and modeling is the beginning of the engineering course, so I use the Inventor program. Currently, we're running the 2013 version. We do have to pay for the license each year, but we found last year when they gave us the 2014, our computers, they won't run it, so they had to uninstall it and then reinstall the 2013 version. Because the graphics and I believe the memory wasn't up to the standard to run the program, because it's a pretty beefy program. We use that a total of 6 weeks out of the year. I teach one group of students, they're in it for about 3 weeks, and then I switch and the other seventh graders come down and we use it another 3 weeks to teach that program. In eighth grade, when Kevin is teaching that portion, they do access that. Maybe once per quarter when they design their windmills, they'll go in and they use the 3D program to design the blades for the windmills. As far as the elective, the related arts course, the robotics, that uses a robot seed program. Currently, it does work on some of the computers, but I know we're having issues that the program itself will not talk to the motor for whatever reason, so you will have to try and get different computers, the ones that are working, to try and talk to the motors to get them to read the program so that the robots will respond. As far as the medical detectives, that is one that Kevin was trained in this summer. And I'm not sure, it doesn't use the programs that we currently have. I'm not sure if this is all online, if it's more of a lab setup, but I do believe there's consumables involved in that one. And then this summer we were talking about the program, we were looking into the green architecture, which that, of course, would use the Autodesk Inventor program again.
So this is one reason why you were saying that we need better computers in that class a couple
Correct.
Months ago?
Right. Exactly.
Go ahead. I've got several. First of all, I'm using 2013 SolidWorks. I haven't used it for a couple years now, obviously. But 2013, I think I got 2012 absolute need, and even with my customers, so they thought absolutely nobody upgrades. So by 2013, it'll be good for the next several years. Question is, will you use anything new that comes out of AutoCAD Inventor? I would give you 99.9 if you never would. I mean, you're using the basics for these kids right now. So the question would be, do we ever need to upgrade that? And should we go through the headache of upgrading that? I would say no. If AutoCAD Inventor is working, now I'm not saying you don't need a computer. You might need a computer to do other things in addition to AutoCAD Inventor at the same time. But I don't know that it would waste some money on upgrading. If it's working for you now, we will prefer a long period of time. So we want that one. But I guess my question would be is, so they're using it to design window blades.
In that one class?
Yeah. And my question is are these kids actually learning it, or are they doing it step by step? Where they do this, then they do this, then they do this, and it tells them what their outcome is supposed to be?
I teach them the beginning. So I teach them how to design, use all the tools, how that works. By the time they're in eighth grade, they actually remember quite a bit, and they understand the program. And then they go on there and they take their designs and they model it in 3D, so they get a better idea if they need to make changes, so they can actually see that.
Okay, so their blade is probably more of a rectangular
they come up with some really unique designs.
Yeah, let's just say, I mean, it's a couple year long course trying to model the spline way of doing that, because there's not a normal, it's contoured, and these things, and I have to get out there at that level that I said, all right, hey, I've got some jobs right now open. I'll hire some of these kids. But that was my big thing, is at the starting level on this, and there's courses that take weeks for just a starting level. Are they actually learning to do it themselves, or is it a step by step guide?
I give them some of the basic instructions on how to get them started. Mm-hmm. So they have the basic idea how to get the shape, how to make it 3D, how to make changes to it so it's not just a box, they can put holes and all these different kinds of things.
Yeah.
They have the basic instructions, and it's just amazing. Some kids, they go from there.
Because I'm mad some kids, it just doesn't click.
Some kids,
working in
yes.
3D world is just
no. There are some kids that struggle, and there are kids that just go way beyond, where there's another project, they take something that they created as a group, and there's no instructions. They have to go and create all the pieces. They make an innovation to something that already exists, and they really do a fantastic job with that.
Okay, great. And how are we merging right now? Have we done any vertical alignment with the high school? I know the high school is using AutoCAD Inventor also.
We're just starting dialogue with them.
It's got to call this.
Okay. Because what I see is the DNA thing and everything in the back here. Oh, I'm a little bit confused by the last sentence of that. Of the system of the human body works together to maintain health. Typically, medical things is after the fact. Who done it kind of thing. I'm not quite certain how the health came into that, but I commend you for trying to insert health into there.
I want the health. Well, and I do believe it is, it's not just a medical crime scene. It's also like, let's say the flu virus. It starts here, so this is how they create the vaccine. It mutates, so it's not, it's also health. It's just not crime scene investigations also.
Yeah, which I think they actually do on the Facebook too.
Right, they do the crime scene some of the high school.
I think it would be epidemic thing. I was trying to work with the younger one, trying to work my way backwards.
That could be. I know for sure they do the crime scene.
Yeah.
If the high school does the open project lead the way, they have their own system. So what happens is the kids will be tracked who took what courses. It'll follow them.
Okay.
And it I do believe it builds on it.
Right.
Because here the important thing is what I don't want to do is have our students being here who have already had some knowledge of AutoCAD Inventor, for example, being stuck into a primary course up there that's just a...
We will have to do some different things with our kids and putting data into the system of what they do in our building that we don't do right now because we don't need to, but just Tammy and I just were talking about this the other day. I don't know if you want to talk about that at all.
Project Leadway updated their whole system since we were trained, so the kids have to be registered through their system, and then it follows them because the high school courses, they can earn college credit for it. So, and it transfers, when I went to the conference a few years back and I sat in on some of the training from high school, I just teach them some of the basics so they get a basic understanding. So they obviously go much more in depth when you get into high school, some of the more complex structures or the more complex tools they would be using there.
Okay.
And when we get some of the transfer kids in, Tammy's talked about, like, some of the kids that come from MPS, different transfer schools that have had this, I mean, they, because sometimes they run these programs on sixth grade. So the kids are quite clear, familiar with what we're doing based upon the school system they've come from also.
Yeah, I mean, you guys can see them push this down further, like into sixth grade or fifth grade, some of these things. I mean, once you start these kids on it, and some kids take to it, they'll just go running with it. Right now, if you knew 3D AutoCAD vendor, the jobs are open. So, I mean, it's obviously a way to go. But I commend you for coming in and showing it to us. We're really interested in what, I guess, the requirements of the computers. Now, I understand we need to update computers every so often because we run other things in addition to them. But I would say if we're capable of running 2013, I would see a reason to upgrade it unless they throw a real good deal, and I don't know what kind of deal we get as a school.
It's a, and I don't know, it could change. We have to pay for a licensing fee, and they send us the updated version. One of the concern I would have if we are continually running 2013, which I can use, I don't know how deep if we go into the green architecture and if, you know, what anything is in the school. If the newer updated version, it may have more, is going to look different, how long can we run an older version? Like, I don't think anybody's using Windows 97 anymore. You know, even though a computer might run it, but so how long can we use this with the computers only being able to run the 2013 version? How many more years? You know, I would hate to see, we pay for this new license that we have to every year, and they come up with whatever.
That's the thing, you actually don't have to pay every year. I mean, same solid, you can pay, once you go 5 years down the line, you can say I want to upgrade. They'll charge you a back fee, which is significantly less than your yearly license fee.
I'm not sure how that works, that tech department or someone would have to look into it.
Do you have the idea, if I have to pay back, you know, something, it's $500 to say, hey, I want to upgrade this 5 years later, it's $500 plus than what the current upgrade fee is. So I may have saved $4,000 or $5,000 over that 5 years from not upgrading. And if I never need the capabilities, then I save myself that much money.
And I don't know how the licensing works with Project Leader.
Yeah, no, it's not Project Leader, it's actually directly licensed with Autodesk.
No, I believe we go right with Project Leader, boy, Dan.
Oh, so they do force.
Correct, so that's where.
So they've got to deal with it, yeah. They're the ones making the,
Correct.
Oh, okay, somebody was making some of them, right? All right, well, that makes more sense than that. Okay. That's one question I have.
Any other questions?
So where do you feel that leads us to the better explanation with?
There are two issues here.
One is the hardware.
Yeah, we should have
one of the software questions, yeah. I mean, the hardware, I'm a firm believer, if you're gonna do something, do it right. And if we have computers where it's not working, and they're not capable of doing things, or we have to hodgepodge things together, then what's the point? I mean, let's get to the point where everything works properly and how it should.
No, I agree with you. I don't know if we need to upgrade it every year at hardware.
Oh,
but every 3 to 4 years on hardware like this.
And that can go to the map and the other where every so often we're able to have the different grade levels.
Right.
The different things, which is perfect. And we can that. I just think we're at that point, it sounds like.
Yeah.
And then do you feel, where do you feel we just left that conversation about the subscription?
I think it's a forced subscription.
Right. So we can have to do it.
Yeah. I think Project Lead the way is making some money on the backside from Autodesk competitors, what I think. So, I mean, if you're forced to take it, you're forced to take it. However, it sounds like you can choose to go backwards. To use a 2013 instead of being forced to take 2014.
Well, we have no choices. Yes. Yeah. So,
so it sounds like either way that will allow you to run whatever you want to. May want to ask them that.
But doesn't Project Lead the way provide materials, and their
right.
materials are going to be written specifically
right.
towards.
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. So their whole goal is to use what is out there in the real world, so they always give the newest version. That's the way their materials are
going to
be
written. So we do need to look at the camera and bring up that at the last tech meeting that we have to update.
Yeah, he wants to get what we needed and give us one to get a little more backstory. Maybe it's an action.
So the only other thing I'll say as I'm reading on here is there's a lot of stuff about green this and green that. I'm sure we'd be interested to see what's meant by that because green is a good saying, it's become kind of cliche over the last few years. Unfortunately, sustainability has been different things to different people. Right now, we have sustainable oil reserves to last us 1,000 years. You can design green, but if nobody's buying green, green architecture becomes a useless cause.
Kevin talks a lot about that. I've been in the room when he's has done that, he's given both sides, the kids have to problem solve both sides, so it's a whole.
So we give a very even-sided, because especially when it comes to
windmills,
battery cars, which have been a flop and a half, windmills, which don't produce any energy, they actually have to require bigger power plants to sustain them. So I sure hope the kids understand that when they drive past all the windmills we have in North, and they're all stopped, that they're not producing a thing when they're sitting there, so. You know, and you have to power plant running in order to maintain power to people's houses at that time. So hopefully we get an even keel thing.
Like I said, for some reason, the past 2 years of his observation, I've been on both those. So I've heard it repeated times.
Perfect, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's really two bigger pieces in the college and career discussion that we're going to talk about. One is what we would call those life skills, those habits that we want all of our students, the career habits, the lifelong habits that we want them to have. We want them to be creative, critical thinkers, communicators, and collaborative. We want them to have an understanding of careers and how they need to think about what they like and think about education and costs and all of those things. We want them to think about their own health and safety. We want them to think about the world and the diversity in the world and how that impacts jobs and life and all those things, and how you can learn from others. And then the information technology skills and then leadership skills. So we have a core group of people, and we're starting small, and then we're branching out. And Mrs. Markle is involved with that group. Jessica Rather, Kevin Brozek, who was going to be here tonight, but he had a little situation he needed to take care of. And Sarah Sigmundson, who's a counselor at Fox River, and then Tricia Kudrovich, who's a counselor at Trailside. And am I missing anybody?
No, that's it.
Okay. And we have an idea of how we're going to move it further, but first, those key people have been studying what is the college and technical education overview in the state of Wisconsin, and it's quite extensive. There are six of these booklets. So as we talk about STEM and the medical detectives, that might fit within the health science, and we have some technology and engineering, but what do we have for family and consumer sciences? What do we have for marketing, management, and entrepreneurship? And what do we have for
agriculture, food, and natural resources. So in the EVE class or the career clusters class, they learned about the 16 career clusters that are out there. And what Wisconsin did was they took those 16 and they made them into six. They kind of combined them so there's a focus of six. So what our goal is, we have one person on each of the, that's on the team. Each member sort of has an emphasis of what they're studying. So Mrs. Markle's kind of looking into the agriculture, food, and natural resources. And there's lots of people looking at different pieces. Our health education might be involved with this. There might be some emotional health involved with the counselors. So it's how are we already embedding these things into our curriculum? And then the question will come at some point as to, okay, what is Waterford Graded School District? Are we going to try to provide an overall foundation like we currently are with the 16 clusters? And then in the STEM, we do that in seventh grade with science and eighth grade with science, and then we have some electives. Do we want to make sure that we're covering opportunities for students in all areas, only some areas? You know, you're gonna have to make some decisions, really, as a Board of Education. So in order for me to sort of prepare that plan and for that discussion, today I just wanna have a little opening discussion on that and to begin to talk about that. But then next month, what I'm hoping to bring to you is, I believe, unless directed elsewise, but I would like to find out more about what the students, which areas of these are the students most interested in too. It's always really important to me that we service the students and make sure that we're not just servicing one type of student, that we're servicing all students. So I think doing some surveys of some of the fifth and sixth grade students, because they're the ones coming up, and maybe the seventh and eighth grade, because the seventh are currently in that course, and the eighth grade have taken the clusters course, plus they've done some of the STEM. So I think that would be critical to get some information from the students, and then I think, of course, as always, it's important to get some information from teachers, and particularly the teachers at the middle school, but maybe five, eight teachers, or maybe all teachers. I'm not sure what the team will decide to do, to find out what they think we should be doing, and then bring that information to you as you know, advisory, so you can know what the feedback is from the staff and from the students. So
that would be great.
Mm-hmm. So in the packet here, as we talk about these two key areas, more of the overall skills, and then the booklets there, just to give you a visual, are the six clusters in the state of Wisconsin. As you see, I have five books because somebody must have one. But what the group did was they, out of these books, they found and grabbed what are the, if we all look at page one of this first document, if you wouldn't mind, please. And it says content area, creativity, critical thinking, communication, and collaboration. And then what they did is they put preschool, you know, now that we're going to be having, you know, 4K, we probably do that. So PK through 5, how well are we doing in that area generally, to get a general idea of that? Blue is, you know, sky's the blue, and we're doing really good on that. That kind of goldish yellow is like, okay, we're doing fine there. And then that kind of orangey pinky color is either we're not really sure about this, or I can't think of anything that would really ensure that all students got this. Okay? So the color coding of that. And so it takes each, they did a nice job, they finished this up the other day. It takes each one of those areas through the leadership, and it sort of does an analysis of where are we at in our district. So they did this last week, I think Tuesday, when my husband was having surgery. So what I will probably do for a Friday update is to just pull the red ones so that you can, and then we can use it for continued discussion in the future too. I haven't really had time to do that yet.
Thank you, Sergeant Rupp, and can I ask you a question?
Sure.
So I'm looking at the first page. specifically grade 6-8 and I agree with 4C1B5.
Okay, 4C1B5M?
It's okay to explain how sometimes working with other people can improve and develop better ideas, but it's not okay to say that only a group of people can come up with a better solution. Otherwise, people such as Steve Jobs never would have invented Apple, right? So it was his idea to say, I'm going to go do this. By taking the approach of a collective, you're never going to wind up with an entrepreneur.
Well, are you reading that's the only way? Because it says can, so it means it's possible.
I just am curious as to how they're going to try to interject that, because I see nothing in there about the individual. I see all about the collective.
Well, I'm sure you have to stop and talk to some people along the way. I mean, I don't think it means that you can't have an idea, but I'm pretty sure, you know, at least it doesn't mean it has helped with the mass group in an organized
study. After the idea is thought of, then you go forward with it, right? But this doesn't say that anywhere on here the individual can come up with an idea. That's a great idea. So my question is where do you insert that and not give it this collectivist idea that they can't come up with a great idea? I mean, you ever watched the show Shark Tank?
Mm-hmm.
You have students on there all the time, right? Kids on there, 11 years old, came up with a great idea and sold the company for $1 million. Their parents may have helped them slightly, but the kid came up with the idea. I saw something to do with locker buddies or something, coming up with something they wanted for the locker. Sold it for $100,000. But it wasn't a collective group that came up with that, the student came up with that idea. They may have, after that, had help to form that idea and progress that idea, but I'd like to see somewhere that they have the idea that, hey, then they as a student and a person could have a great idea that's doable. And nobody has to agree with you, but it's your idea. It goes forward and wins or fails based on their efforts.
Yeah, I guess I understand your interpretation of that. I don't read that all of that into that. I think at a student level.
But my question is, where did this paperwork come from?
The state of Wisconsin.
That's why I'm bringing this up, because although you read Tony Evers' letter, Tony Evers is a nice guy, he's a legend, I don't agree with Tony Evers on those issues. So the question comes down to, Tony Evers calls off about state statutes. The legislature gave the directive to the DPI to do something. It did not tell the DPI they had the right to force the schools to do it. And this is where you guys got to keep it account. The last Tony Evers brought up, he said it was the schools brought up the idea of Common Core. It was not the school, it was the state DPI working associated with the federal government that forced Common Core into our schools. So now Tony Evers is backtracking and saying, oh, no, I never did that. Well, he sure did. He came by and he said, you guys told me you got to do this. And schools all went along. So this is where this is not a thing that is forced on our school. So we can modify this as we see fit, and we don't have to do anything. I suggest we read the state statute that they passed and say, what are we required to do? It'll stay in there.
Right. If you read the letter from the state superintendent, the line specifically what we need to do, and as far as what you're bringing up, certainly modify the wording of those pieces.
Yeah, but the legislature gives them what they need to do. For example, they were the ones that came up with educator effectiveness, and they were directed to come up with a system that was available statewide for the computer system, and they were allowed to give money towards it to allow the schools to implement this. It does not say in there what the schools have to do. For example, there's nothing in there that the school has to allow educator effectiveness at all. You can throw it out the door tomorrow, and there's nothing in state statutes and no law that says what will happen to the schools.
Not will happen to it, but if we don't use educator effectiveness, then we can need to come up with a plan and have submitted authority to the state for a
report. The state statute is not true. We don't have to do our thing.
I think we need to come back to this issue. So you'd like us to read this and
come
back and get some more feedback about our teachers and students.
Right. And if there are any of them, other ones that Dan, he came up with a couple, just star those, Dan, and then send those to me, and I can work on some revisions, slight revisions, so that it can be work for us
here. Well, can I select the state statute? It's fluttered right in there.
So this is the only state statute pertaining to it.
All right. So, any other questions on that?
I would only add that as we look at things like this, that we also have an awareness of what high school is doing. Just so as we're planning things and say, okay, we can offer students this types of education opportunities that they take it in ninth grade and it just doesn't die there because there isn't a similar opportunity at high school.
Right. I think you're, we're in a position where we need to make the best decisions for our K-8 students, and we certainly can try to influence what we believe is best for our students in the future, but that's certainly for that school district to decide what they're going to do.
Well, no, I know, but if we
just sit down together and sort of work together to carry on the policies, is what I'm saying.
I just mean if we're looking at things and we're saying, well, we can't do everything, we only have the means to do this, and this, to have an awareness of what the continuing education opportunities are, I think would be helpful in making a decision of what we can do.
Yeah. And they can influence either way, because it could limit you and limit the students. I just want to be aware that there's pros and cons of that, because we're constantly saying, well, what if they're going to do it in the high school, and sometimes
I think... You can also try to influence them if they
are. If they're not doing the program that we believe we should be having for our students, maybe we could influence them in a positive way.
No, I'm not saying I wouldn't do it. I'm not saying that at all. I would just like to know.
And Mr. Yeo just started those conversations.
According to Mr. Eater, is it's a 6-3-12 thing anyway, right? Yeah.
I think so.
It says 6-3-12 anyway.
Thanks for starting our thinking. Okay, good. All right, just a little quick update, on the 4-year-old kindergarten. We are going to have another 4-year-old kindergarten registration date. I'm working with Jen on that, but she'll set that up and get that going. So we have another opportunity. We'll put out those flyers and do all of that again. And then we do have a screening, so that'll be some more information, and more people will be talking about the screening when that occurs in May, which also might generate more people who are interested in registration, as well as this week is kindergarten registration. So people might ask, or kids might come in that are younger, and we can get those students registered in the 4K. And then Mr. Yolk and I met with Jen Sick, met with the bus company to talk about that, and we have another date set up for the last week in January to look at how do the bus routes look with the students that we have that are scheduled to come. So we'll have some further conversation on that as to AM, PM, how's it look, how many buses, what the system cost, those kinds of things. And then working with Susie for information on the on-site childcare, and hopefully next month we'll bring that back to you so that we can continue that ball rolling too. Okay. And then just an overall piece of information that I started that early learning collaboration partnership last year. We met one time in the spring, and then we met prior to the 4K beginning, but we'll continue meeting with them, and we have a meeting on Friday of this week, 12:30 to 2:30, that Jenna Bloom will facilitate, and to keep the conversations going, even though we don't have all the answers to everything regarding 4K, but to continue to invite all of the child care centers as well as the library and those pieces so that they can be as informed, and that we can try to continue to value those partnerships and have plans to do. So I'll let you know if there's any questions on that Friday. One other thing that I think is put on there is human growth and development. It's time to update our plans. Our state, every 3 years, a school district has to review the human growth and development, and so we are having our meeting. Since the board meeting is not on the 19th, we're having our meeting with clergy. Dawn is going to be there as a board rep. We have parents, Shirley and Darlene are on that, health teachers, counselors, school nurse, so just at, I think it's 4 o'clock to 5 o'clock on January 19th. So then those pieces, and if there's any changes or recommendations, will come to you then.
Thank you.
Bummer.